Hi, I'm Toby and welcome to The Joy of Physics. In this video, I'm not going to use any mathematical equations and I hope it will be fairly simple to follow. I'm going to talk about rainbows and how they are formed whilst drawing some artwork on the board. So I hope you stay to follow along with me. I'll start with drawing in the sky here. Some dark blue clouds mixed with highlights of white. Rainbows are really the most amazing thing, a beautiful decoration on the sky. I will always want to stop and look at a rainbow if I happen to see one. The physics behind a rainbow has been fairly well understood since Newton's time, but it wasn't until I did some extra research for this video that I think I really understood. I knew it was something to do with refraction and reflection of light within water droplets, but I kind of left my explanation at that. Today, I hope to help you properly see rainbows and learn more about them. Rainbows caused by sunlight always appear in the section of sky directly opposite the sun. We need the sun, then us, and in front of us, we need some water droplets, commonly delivered in the form of rain. So rainbows are usually seen in the early morning or late afternoon, when we can line all of those components up. It's not usually raining beneath your feet at midday, so you wouldn't normally see a rainbow then, but you might if you perhaps use a hose. So I'm not drawing the sun in my picture today, since it would be behind me. I'm just drawing some nice clouds in here with a little sunlight highlighting them. It was Isaac Newton, friend of the channel, who took a glass prism and used it to study the way that white light from the sun can split into a spectrum of colours. Newton filled his room with colourful patterns of light this way, and you would have seen such things in your everyday life. Maybe the way light comes through a window or a glass ornament and streaks colours across your room. Why don't I pause my landscape there for a moment and show you this giant raindrop. Now, we might be used to drawing raindrops as tear-shaped, perhaps because when a water droplet falls down a glass window or a tear falls down our face, it is tear-shaped, because friction with the glass or with our skin drags some of the water up into a tail. But in air, friction is actually much less, and falling raindrops are spherical. This is the cross-section of a water droplet that I painted earlier. Now light, when it hits a medium like water or glass, will slow down and bend. Light from the sun is made up of all the colours of the rainbow, and these colours will each bend a different amount, which gives our first tiny rainbow in here, with blue light bending more than red. At this interface, some of the light will also be reflected off the droplet and never come inside. At our second boundary over here, some of the light will exit the droplet and speed up as it goes back into air, but some will be reflected again. At our third interface here, again, some of the light will exit, and this exiting light here will be the primary rainbow that we see, but some light will continue to bounce around inside of the droplet. If the light had been incident in the middle here, it would have gone straight through. If it had come in right at the top here, it would have followed a different path and come out somewhere over here. The path that I have drawn is a path where the angle between the incident light and the exiting red light is 42 degrees. This happens to be the maximum exit angle for the red light and also its maximum intensity. The red light can't exit out anywhere over here. This is its maximum angle, so it can come out here or anywhere in here. The other colours all have their own maximum intensity and maximum exit angles, and they are slightly less than the red. Because our raindrop is spherical, and because light from the sun is incident at all of those angles at the same time, there will be a ring of incident angles like that one I just showed you. The result of that is that we will end up from a single water droplet having a cone of red light at 42 degrees. The maximum exit angle for blue light was lower, around 40 degrees, so that cone will be a little smaller with all the other colors in between. From one water droplet, we will end up with a circular ring of rainbow with white in the middle where all of the different colors are mixing together. But this is not what we would see. Our eyes are pretty small and we only see the light that reaches them. If this one water droplet was directly in front of me and all I was seeing was the light from the center, then what I would see would just be white light. If this one water droplet was above me, say at an angle of 42 degrees from my eyes, all I would see would be red light. If it was slightly lower, all I would see would be orange light with maybe a hint of red. Lower again, I would see yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. And this is the important part of the explanation. The rainbow that we see is not just one water droplet splitting light into colors, but it is the result of many water droplets working together. I will see red light from an arc of water droplets in the sky, all 42 degrees away from my eye. And likewise with the other colors, I will see an orange arc or a yellow or a green or a blue arc from all of the water droplets that are in just the right place and just the right angle from my eye to show me that intensity of color. One droplet alone makes a rainbow cone, but like all things in life, we can achieve more if we work together. To see a rainbow, we are seeing the combined effort of millions, maybe even trillions, of water droplets. But maybe you have high expectations and think that trillions of raindrops ought to achieve more than just one rainbow. And well, you would be right. There is never just one rainbow. Everyone gets their own unique rainbow. If I had a friend standing next to me, she would see a different rainbow formed by the raindrops that happen to be at the correct angular direction to send the different colors of light into her eyes. So, just like people, every rainbow is unique. The colors of the rainbow are continuous, but for the purpose of drawing them, we usually split them up into seven distinct bands. Newton divided his spectrum up into seven colors too, which he liked because of an ancient Greek belief that there was a connection between the colors, the musical notes, the known objects in the solar system, which must have been seven at the time, and the days of the week. This indigo we speak of looks suspiciously like dark blue to me, but each to their own. The question of whether everyone sees seven colors in a rainbow is related to the idea of linguistic relativity. You might think that everyone perceives a rainbow in the same way, but perhaps the number of distinct colors observed and what these are called depend on the language one uses, with people whose language has fewer color words seeing fewer discrete bands. I'll link some research that suggests that in the description. It's just a little reminder that we all perceive reality a little differently. It is kind of true that we can't really see the full rainbow. I'm seeing red light from the droplets all 42 degrees away from my eye, but the full set of droplets that match that description would make a ring. However, about half of that ring is blocked off by the horizon. So we only see a rainbow from the droplets that not only meet the right angle, but are also in the sky. Because of this, we do perhaps miss out on seeing the full beauty of the rainbow, but perhaps it is also a case of less is more. as I draw in these trees here, I try to remember that less is sometimes more, and I'll try not to go overboard. If you could see a rainbow from above with the sun behind you, then you would see a full circle. I had known that fact for a while, and I was once on a plane flying into Wellington, which is a very windy city, and I'm an anxious flyer, so it's not the most fun to land there. But I looked out the window and could see a rainbow ring around the plane. I thought this must be a rainbow from above, and I was really excited. But according to a Google search I did the other day, it was actually something called a glory, rather than a rainbow from above. Glories are smaller and the result of diffraction of light within the clouds. That doesn't mean it wasn't awesome, because glories are their own special and magic kind of physics, but it wasn't the rainbow from above that I thought it was. That would be a lot larger. I'm just giving this happy little tree here some friends to hang out with. Another phenomenon is the 22 degree halo, which appears around the sun or moon, unlike a rainbow, which would appear opposite in the sky. Halos are the result of ice crystals rather than water droplets. So at least I now know not to call any of these other things rainbows, even though they are just as inspiring. I would like to be a rainbow hunter. I don't know if that kind of person exists, but the idea of going around looking for different types of rainbows seems really nice to me. A bit more chill than being a storm chaser. I love the idea of geometric optics. It's something that's kind of understandable, but also still built on complex ideas. It's beautiful and inspiring. It's a branch of physics that explains something that we all find wonderful. The sky inside a primary rainbow is brighter than the sky outside of the bow because of that mixing of a little of every colour. The light here is being hugged by a rainbow, and how nice is that? So I'll make it a little bit whiter on my artwork here. Now, we didn't forget about our light friend who was still reflecting around inside of the water droplet, and it will eventually emerge from the droplet, forming a second rainbow, which you can sometimes spot. Since it has been reflected again, the colours will be in the opposite order, and the white light will be on the exterior, not interior, leading to a dark band between the two bows called Alexander's band. We lose some light at each reflection, and the second rainbow is spread over a larger part of sky, so the second rainbow will always be fainter than the first, but in theory is always there. It's usually too faint to see though. There will also be higher order rainbows, such as from a third or fourth reflection, but these are very rare to see, unless you're trying to reconstruct them in a lab, and in that case you might have a bit more luck. It's just another reminder that behind every bright person we see, there are often other people, like their friends and family, supporting them, even if you can't always see them. No rainbows are alone, their friends are just a little shy. Now, it's not all just simple reflection. The very nature of quantum mechanics is even peeking through in a rainbow. Because of very small droplets, less than 1 millimeter across, sometimes narrow, faintly coloured bands can be seen near the violet edge of a rainbow. These are called supernumerary bows and cannot be explained by classical geometric optics, but rather that they are caused by the interference between rays of light following slightly different paths with slightly varying lengths within the raindrops. This interference was one of the first indications of the wave nature of light, and first explained by Thomas Young in 1804. I'll add in some birds, and some stars and planets to our sky here to make it feel a little more magical. The double rainbow is not the only curious variation that a rainbow hunter could find. At sunset or sunrise, when only red light is in the sky, we can see an entirely red rainbow. At night, the moon may illuminate a moonbow. Groups of different sized raindrops may lead to twinned rainbows, which are side by side. Perhaps the coolest thought of all is that rainbows probably exist elsewhere in the solar system. On Saturn's moon Titan, there is a very wet surface with humid clouds of mostly methane, and I wonder how a methane rainbow would look. I find that a very inspiring thought. And I think we'll call that finished. Thank you for staying with me to the end of the video. I hope you have an absolutely mathematical day. And if you're interested in learning more about the physics in the world around us, then check out this video's sponsor, Brilliant. You can set a goal to improve your scientific knowledge and chip away at it every day. Brilliant makes that possible with interactive explorations and a mobile app so that you can learn wherever you are. Their course on waves and light will work up your knowledge to understanding more optical phenomena. Head to brilliant.org/tibbies, the link is below, and the first 200 people to do so will get 20% off their annual subscription. You can always give the gift of knowledge too, by gifting premium to someone else. Thanks to Brilliant, and thanks to my Patreon supporters for making this video possible, including today's Patron Cat of the Day, Mimi. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.